All right. Oh, mama, can this really be the end? To be stuck inside the Bing with those Memphis blues again. Oh, guy, thanks, David. Thank you. Oh, man, this is really, what a week. I want to thank everybody. David, there's no board people here, right? No, so yeah, okay. Don't have to thank them. That's right, that's good. But I want to thank staff. The staff is amazing, and what they do, and what they've done this week, and how they all just sort of like get behind the wheel and just create these things. The faculty, this faculty, which is an extraordinary group of people. I mean, really, I mean, this is like, if you dropped a bomb on us, the American theater would die right now. I want to thank the MFA writers, John, Mary, and Hannah, for allowing, you know, this old guy to babble on. Not long, I promise, not long. And I promise everything I have to say derogatorily will not be directed at you. But I have my last shot at these guys. You know, it's commencements. They're supposed to, the tradition of commencement is, yeah, I'm supposed to leave you with sound and practical advice that you can just take on and move away and whatever. So, I mean, I don't know what to tell you because it's my commencement too. I'm graduating today. And so I have to talk to myself as well. And yeah, and you know, it's not something new. I mean, but I do have to walk it like I talk it. I mean, it'll be good. It'll be good advice. It will be sound advice. I promise you, you'll be able to take it to the bank. Okay, I'm going to give it to you right now. Wear clean underwear at your costume fittings. Writers, if you have a writing deadline, make sure you change your clothes at least every 5 days. Thank your servers. They may be you. Drink lots of water. Breathe. That's pretty basic. I mean, that you should at least, with an MFA, walk away with that. Eat a mint before your love scene. And if you're late to an appointment, don't blame the LA traffic because somebody in that room got there on time. Donate to the School of Dramatic Arts when you become a star, but make sure the pilot goes to series before you write the check. Or before you buy that house. Imitate and steal from the best. And remember and always consider the cat. Good. So that's it. Thank you. And it was a pleasure. No? Oh. Okay. Fuck. What do I say now? That man, my muse, tell. Tell of that man of twists and turns who was buffeted far and wide after he'd laid Troy low. He saw all kinds of country and fathomed men's minds. He bore all sorts of trials out on the open ocean, struggling to survive and to bring his comrades home. He couldn't keep them, though, for all his effort. Muse, tell us that story too, beginning where you will. It's my favorite thing. When I was a kid, I remember buying the classic comics version of the Odyssey and just tearing it apart because I loved it so much. Can you imagine? You know, I asked Warshawski, what should I talk about? He says, well, you know, you once said this thing about there's no app for what we do. And there isn't. Can you imagine walking into a room and there's this blind guy with a lyre, lyre. I don't mean someone who lies for him, but it's a musical instrument. And he starts telling this story. The story is about, and you know, human beings and who we are and where we come from and why we're here. Yeah, I mean stories. I mean still, that's my deep faith and the attraction to all of this work is because I love the stories. And I know you do too. Trying to make sense of our lives and what happens to us and trying to make sense of our death. I mean, this is the deal with theater. No matter how technologically advanced we get, it comes down to the blind guy with a lyre. But except that now, it's there's been a division of labor. Instead of the original story creator and teller, we now have writers and we have actors and who join together to tell the story, their story, our story. And as far as I'm concerned, this is why I'm so glad that there are writers here. And first I thought, well, I don't know the writers, and I know the actors, because I spent 3 years with the actors in these rooms. But I realized it was a blessing that I had to include the writers, because I do believe that the crucial relationship in the theater is that relationship between the writer and the actor. Amen. It is. It is. And the thing is, it's a relationship that's often served in a weird way. You know, I mean, that somehow we do different things. And we do different things. We have different crafts. You have your craft, we have our craft. But the thing is that the whole point of it is, when we create these stories, is to bring those crafts together. I mean, the farmers and the cowboys should be friends. I mean, the word. The word created, written, the word embodied, the word put into action. That becomes the story. And that's why we need to keep this relationship between the writer and the actor healthy, clean, sane. So I have 4 or 5 pieces of advice. You know, honest advice, I think. And so my first piece is that writers and actors not just support each other, but desire each other's artistic company. I mean, to be generous and open and honest with each other. I mean, it's we're not adversarial. This is a practice that we, I mean, we practice different crafts, but the symbiosis of the two creates the power and the dimension of theater. I mean, we're both engaged, deeply engaged in the investigation of what it means to be a human being. That's it. What else is there? Why do we write plays? Why do we act plays? What it means to be a human being. What is it about that makes us each individually unique and different? We each of us has our own point of view, the way we see the world, the way we experience the world. And that takes such empathy to be able to represent different points of view. I mean, writers just don't write words, type them out, and actors just don't learn them and memorize them, recite them. I mean, it's such an incredibly weird thing we do, isn't it? I mean, it's really so weird. We write plays, we act in plays, we create images with words, we embody these words, we find actions to play them out, we show them, show ourselves, you know, look at me, listen to me, I have something to say, something I want to share with you, show you. But then we have to figure out what it is that we have to say. What is the story? Our story. And you're right, Sean, our story changes every day. But there's that basic bottom line that keeps thrumming and thrumming away. That is our story. The twists and turns. I mean, it was easier when we were kids. We would just take whoever was the nearest person hostage, you know, whether usually parents or siblings or someone, and then we'd make them watch and listen to us as we acted out some TV show or some movie. And some of the most, I mean, I love my children, but it was some of the most tedious and hateful moments of my life to go through that. You know, but as MFAs, we can't do that. We're professionals. And we ask people to pay money to hear and see us. So how do we do that? How do we find this story we want to tell? So my second piece of advice is get dirty. Cultivate. Dig up the dirt of your imagination. Check out the worms and the bacteria that are eating and shitting and moving through and flourishing within and striving to grow and expand. You know, the impulses, the images that constantly move through us. Capture them, wrestle with them. Bring them to ground into the body. But that's easier said than done, isn't it? Because then there's always the blank page. It's not just writers who have the blank page, the writer's block. Actors have the blank page. You know, it's for an actor, it's the blank page is anything from chronic unemployment to not being able to find a point of view or an inner life for the character he or she is playing. I mean, we've all, you know, those of us actors all stepped out on a stage and suddenly your body turns into a 2x4 and you have nothing to say. Nothing to say except the words. And believe me, writers just don't want you reciting. They can't want us just to recite. That was so lifeless and boring. They want us to come in with our humanity cultivated and mushed around and sort of flowing out of us. And then polluting the environment or sweetening it, whatever it's supposed to do. But that blank page it can be the kind of fear that paralyzes or drives one to overindulge bad habits. So, third piece of advice is to find an antidote. That's easier said than done also. Find the antidote for this thing that paralyzes us, that this blank page that looks at us. And each person has to come up with his or her own antidote. I mean, I'm not going to give you, you know, one size fits all kind of deal here. But my suggestion, my third piece of advice is that you always take an action. You always take an action, no matter how small or how seemingly insignificant, that moves you toward what you want. Something that's going to help you to create your own personal work ethic. It's an interesting word, ethic. Usually involves right and wrong, but the work ethic is what is right for you. As you develop a process, as you create the ethos that supports your work, that supports your artistic desire. And creating that moral space that protects your integrity, your togetherness. Integrity is a daily practice. Just because believe me, I'm so guilty of this, you know, that you have a performance and you put it all together in that performance. You figure, that's it, I solved it, that's it, I've got it. Or I'm sure for writers, it's the same thing. I've written this thing, it's perfect, it's great. But you really are only as integrated as your last thing. It doesn't stop. If anything, the stakes get raised each time. So no matter what you do, just do it. Just do something. Practice integrity. Do something. Jesus, just don't stand there or sit there. I mean, it's like, do something. Remember the first time in class I asked you, that first class? I just said, get up and do something. You know, and you all look, I mean, you know, it was like, it was a frightening moment. It was a frightening moment for me to see the fright on your face. I mean, think, oh, Jesus, I just asked him to do something. Things change. Things fall apart. Things die. But integrity is having a process that goes about to reintegrate, to rebuild, to revive, to put ourselves and our work back together, not in the same way, shape, or manner, but in something new, something surprising, something that's different. You're inventing it every day, every moment, just the way we're inventing our lives every day and every moment. I mean, the different roles we play, the different roles that we write, the themes that we grapple with. I mean, yeah, we can take stuff. We're talking about this outside. You can take, borrow stuff, steal, and I'm all for that. But eventually, you gotta have your own point of view with it. It's gotta fit somewhere, some one of your many facets. There's got to be something that you want to say through whatever you're stealing. I never thought of it that way, actually. So make those choices that support your ethos. Find your community. Find your friends. Find those people, find those lovers that support and empower your ethos. That's my fourth piece of advice. Find your allies. I mean, you found some here, but there are more. There are people out there who are just dying to make the connection with you. Find the people you want to work with and who want to work with you. I think this is my favorite thing about the theater. And why I've stayed the course for over 50 years, and why I speak with genuine enthusiasm about this. I mean, this isn't fucking put on. This is my life. This is what I do. This is my practice. Adrian Ramos the other day said this thing that rocked me. He said, "You want to go fast? Go alone. You want to go far? Go together." And when you said that, Aid, it's like it didn't sound, it wasn't a cliche. It was like something that really just dropped into me. I mean, in this game, if we learn how to play together, it's half the battle, talking about half the battle. And find your soulmates. That's part of this. Fourth piece of advice. If you haven't already, I know some of you already have. Because intimacy is powerful. It's healing. It strengthens. It gives joy. I mean, after today, I'm out of here. But I'm going home. And Irene's going to be there. Okay, last piece of advice, fear. And it's funny, because Connie Britton, who spoke at the undergraduate thing, she talked about fear today. And because fear is so powerful, but it's not that it's so powerful. It's that we've made it a taboo, that somehow to be afraid is something that is not natural. But fear is a great dynamic. It's a dynamic that pits our soul against the belief that we can't change, we can't grow, we can't expand and move towards our heart's desire. We have to accept the imagery, our personal imagery, because each of us has our own personal imagery of fear, what it smells like, what it tastes like, what it feels like. What is it that haunts us? What is it that gives us our nightmares? It's not to be denied. That's to be accepted. I mean, you reject your fear, you reject yourself, and a great source of power. I mean, we're all mortal. We're all mortal. And we come by fear honestly. We deny fear, we deny our humanity. So, as I say, today's my graduation as well. And as Warshawski says, experience is the only thing that separates us as artists. It's the only thing, life experience. And what I've been teaching here for the past 14 years is, I do believe it's what I've been trying to learn myself. I mean, learn at a deeper level, to relearn, to remember. I think what it is that I wanted to learn was how to live in a changing world, a changing body. And believe me, this body is changing. I wanted to reaffirm on a daily basis that the process of becoming a craftsman, a man with a craft, or a woman with a craft, hopefully an artist who sees behind appearances, that this process is inseparable from becoming a human being. Like you, humanity is my study, my practice, the model for my work. I needed to come to this school. And now, like you, I'm going to whatever is next. You know, at one point in my life, I came to believe that roles would come to me, would find me out, and not the other way around. And because I was always random, you know, get a role, you go out, you know, audition and stuff like that. But the important roles, the roles that change your life, and they come to me, and they seek me out to teach me what I need to learn about whatever I need to learn to move forward in my work, in my life. And this happened with this one play, especially at the Center Theater Group, Mark Taper Forum, this thing called In the Belly of the Beast. And I had quit, before then, I had quit the business. I had done a lot of really bad television in the 70s, and I was really tired of it, and I was confused, and a lot of stuff was going on, so I quit. And Irene and I, we just cashed out here, and then we moved to the mountains and did other stuff. And then we did other stuff, and that's when I started teaching, and, you know, started teaching kids. I started teaching little kids at this town hall in this little town of 2,000 people. They had this funky little town hall. And I would take up my viola spolin, and I would do theater games with them. And then I would write plays. I would write plays about visitors from another planet or, you know, and stuff like that. And the kids would do them. And I was so happy doing this. I was so happy. And then that one thing led to another. And after 4 years of this, I get a call from the former dean, Madeline Puzo, saying there is a play that we're doing at the Taper 2, which was their experimental. They used to have an experimental thing. I think, Oliver, you were there then at that time. And they did it at the John Anson Ford, but not the theater outside. There's this dungeon downstairs. Huh? So this dungeon downstairs was perfect. Are you talking to me again? What? And I was playing the role of this guy Jack Henry Abbott, who spent his life in prison, and who had spent his entire life in prison. At one point, spent 14 years in solitary confinement, straight. And he started writing letters to Norman Mailer. And in the correspondence between he and Norman Mailer realized that this guy was a mad genius. This guy was a great writer. But he was mad. The prison and solitary confinement had driven him mad. And he wrote about the morality, the ethos of prison, and how morality is upside down there. And one of the most extraordinary parts of the book is when he justifies murder. And he justifies it by creating this scenario, which I'm sure he did, of how you murder someone who's threatening you. And so, to make a long story short, so he got out of prison because the book became a big hit, big, you know, sort of like literary hit in New York. And so Mailer and Jerzy Kosinski and some other, you know, big writers helped to get him out. And they took him from years of solitary confinement to a halfway house on the Lower East Side of Manhattan, where he went out to dinner one night. And he went everywhere he went. He carried this little kitchen knife that he had at the kitchen of the halfway house. And he went to this restaurant that was right 2 blocks down from where I used to live on 2nd Avenue and 6th Street. And walked into this restaurant. And back in the day, you know, he asked, where's the bathroom? And this guy, who was an out-of-work actor, who was working as a waiter, who was kind of a New York smartass, he said, man, you got to go outside. You got to go outside. And he was talking like a real New Yorker. And this guy Abbott was from Utah and from solitary confinement and from the planet Mad, and so the guy takes him outside and takes him around the corner on 6th Street. And as this guy Richard Aden is pointing to the dumpster where Abbott could take a leak, Abbott pulls out his knife and plunges it in his heart and kills him. And so then, based on that, based on the trial from that murder and also his book, Madeline Puzo and Robert Woodruff were doing this production of In the Belly of the Beast, and I played Abbott. And I had up to that point felt like that I was in prison, that I had been exiled from the business, and that I was in my own little sort of like cell. And That was the role that brought me out. That's the role that brought me here, actually. I would not be here if it hadn't been for that role. But I'm saying this because my job here at SDA is no different. I mean, I turned it down. I didn't want to come here when Madeline offered me the opportunity to apply to create a new MFA program. I didn't think it was for me. But it turns out I needed to work here. I needed the company of gifted colleagues. And I needed you guys, the initiates, the acolytes, the apprentices, to bring me back to what Shunryu Suzuki calls the beginner's mind, that would allow me to learn something new about myself. And along with the Davids, Bridell and Warshawski, Natsuko, Andre, Charlotte Cornwell, you were my teachers, and you are out there, you guys, first, second years. You were my teachers. And I learned as much from you, if not more, than you ever got from me. And I do really feel that now I can go and take my work to the next place. I think we can all go to that next place. I want to finish with one thing. Peter Brook, who has been this kind of like this North Star for me, always. I met him once. Was the weirdest thing. We're in Paris in this little neighborhood restaurant, I mean, funky place. And it's crowded, but the place was good and it was cheap. So that's why we would go there a lot. And it was always crowded and smoke and shit. Irene and I walked in there and said, oh God, there's no room. The guy, the waiter said, no, over in the corner, just over. So he squeezes us over and squeezed down in the corner and I sit down. And here is Brooke sitting right next to me, eating, and I lost my appetite, and I literally had to do this because I did not want to disturb the man. So I just played with my food until I knew he was finished, and played with my food, and then he got up, and I jumped up, and I said, Mr. Brooke, I have to tell you, your work has meant so much to me. And he looked at me, and he said, well, that's very kind of you, very kind. And tell me, what kind of work do you do? And I couldn't say it. I couldn't say it. I stammered. I didn't tell him I was an insurance agent. I think I probably did, but I... Anyway, so he writes, theater is always both a search for meaning and a way of making this meaning meaningful to others. This is the mystery. And a recognition of mystery is very important. When man loses his sense of awe, life loses its meaning. And it is not for nothing that in its origins, the theater was a mystery. However, the craft of the theater cannot remain mysterious. If the hand that wields the hammer is imprecise in its movement, it will hit the thumb and not the nail. The ancient function of theater must always be respected, but without the sort of respect that sends one to sleep. There is always a ladder to be climbed, leading from one level of quality to the next. But where is this ladder to be found? Its rungs are details, the smallest of details, moment by moment. Details are the craft that leads to the heart of the mystery. Thank you all for inviting me.